There is a new book on its way from Crazy 8 Press. It is an anthology of adventure stories in the tradition of the old pulp magazines of the turn of the century. And joining us to talk about it now, Mr. Robert Greenberger. He is editing said anthology. It is called Thrilling Adventure Yarns. Bob, thanks very much for joining us today. What was the impetus for this kind of anthology? This is not something that you see on the shelf all the time anymore in the bookstores.
No, not really. First of all, thanks for having me, Jason. The pulp magazines really started in the late 1800s, and they were dime magazines, and they were either specific genre stories or multiple genre stories. The writers were paid so cheaply, they had to write by the pound to make a living. So they were fast, they were furious, they were imaginative. And this is where we got Conan the Barbarian by Robert E. Howard, and Tarzan and John Carter by Edgar Rice Burroughs, Lester Dent's Doc Savage, Maxwell Grant, The Shadow. These magazines fueled the imagination at a time where people needed escapist literature. They were particularly popular during the Great Depression because you couldn't afford much else than a dime magazine to entertain yourself for a few hours. These things sold very, very well. So things like The Shadow were twice monthly publications at their peak.
And these are also the what we were called the Penny Dreadfuls at the time, right?
Which is
where the Showtime anthology gets its name from that same style of story.
Absolutely. And because they were so imaginative, most of the best of those characters have stayed in part of pop culture for the last 100 years. My Crazy 8 Press peers and I were steeped in this stuff, reading the paperback reprints from Bantam and Lancer in the 60s and 70s, up through the more recent facsimiles that Anthony Tolan has been doing of the best of the pulp magazines. And every year, Crazy 8 Press does a sampler anthology where we all come together and we pick a theme of one sort or another. And we rotate who gets to edit, and it was my turn. And it occurred to me that this would be a tremendous amount of fun to give back, to go back to the stuff that inspired us and give everybody a chance to write a Penny Dreadful. So once I mentioned it to everybody, they glommed onto it really fast. The last time anybody tried something like this was Michael Chabon back in 2010 with a special edition of McSweeney's magazine. So I guess, you know, he was also inspired in the same way. After everybody signed on, I realized we needed more. So I invited other people, friends of Crazy 8, to join us on this campaign, one of whom was Will Murray. Will has been writing about the pulp magazines, I don't know, 20, 30 years now. He is officially continuing the adventures of Doc Savage, and he's written Tarzan books and all. One of the other hats he wears is he is the literary agent for the Lester Dent Estate. So after agreeing to write a story for my book, he said, by the way, would you like an unpublished Lester Dent story?
I said, oh my.
He said, sure, how much? And he gave me a price. And I realized that to afford a good cover and a logo and the story, and it'd be nice to pay the writers, it seemed like I wanted to raise the money, and Kickstarter made the most sense. So I did all the grunt work. I mean, this is my first real campaign. So there was a learning curve involved. And we launched nearly 2 weeks ago, by the time we hear this, on Saturday. And I was astounded. We launched on a Sunday night, and in 6 days, I made goal. It was a $4,500 goal. I didn't know there were that many people interested. The velocities caught me by surprise. The first stretch goal was to be able to add stories by Will Murray, Peter David, and Keith R.A. DeCandido. That was a $5,000 stretch goal. We hit that a couple of days later. We're well on our way to our second stretch goal, which is hopefully allowing me to offer an upgrade to a hardcover edition of the book. My real stretch goal that I'd love to get to is the 7,000 stretch goal, where I will have enough money to hire illustrators to do interior illustrations like the old pulp magazines had. So people who have been in the Kickstarter campaign say, oh yeah, you'll get there. You're well on your way. I'm not going to rest on my laurels. I'm going to keep doing this until February 19th when the deadline hits. If I get to 7,000, I will be the happiest man in Maryland, if not the United States, but we'll go from there.
Now, you mentioned the velocity of reaching your goal, not going over the goal. You still have lots of days to go on this campaign. And we've seen, both on Kickstarter and Indiegogo, a number of comic book projects that are in this same kind of, we want to make adventure stories, and they've raised quite a bit of money as well. But on the flip side of that, not to get into too much of the weeds with controversy, there have recently been criticism of that kind of story, that kind of two-fisted, real man's man adventure stories, as being behind the times and not in step with the modern era. Is that a concern for you? When you plan these stories out, are you thinking about those kinds of sensibilities, or is that not an issue? You just want to really get into the same tone and style of those stories from back then?
I think because we are paying an homage to something that was very transformative in its day, I truly believe that the same criticism won't apply to us, because we're doing it with a sense of purpose. We're doing it to tribute, and I think we'll be okay there.
Okay.
But there's a place for those sorts of stories. Don't get me wrong. I mean, it's why Baskin Robbins has 31 flavors. There's something for everybody.
So you've got your authors lined up. You're putting your stories together. What kind of a timetable are we looking at for when this book will be available?
Our annual sampler is always targeted to debut at the Shoreleaf Convention, which is here in Maryland, which is usually the second weekend in July. And we are on target for that. I, specifically set a set of deadlines. And anyone who knows me knows I'm very task-driven, very deadline-oriented. Mm-hmm. And that means we are on target. My stories are already being written. Everyone's got faith in us. There should be no problem having that book available in print at Shoreleaf, and then the backer copies, since many of the people already bid for a print copy with autographs, we'll have a big autograph party at Shoreleaf, since so many of the authors will be there, and then they'll be shipped out in July on schedule.
You mentioned, as part of your stretch goals, getting contributors such as Peter David, Keith DeCandido. What authors do you have already contributing to the anthology?
Okay, the Crazy Eight Press team will be Peter David, Michael Jan Friedman, Aaron Rosenberg, Glenn Howman, Mary Fan, me, Russ Colchimiro, Paul Kupperberg. All of us veteran writers at different stages in our careers. And joining us is Jennifer Rosenberg and Kathleen O'Shea David, deeply connected to some of us here. We've got Robert Jashanek, Will Murray, Paige Daniels, Amy Kalinske. Trying to remember all the names. There are about 17 of us, plus Lester Dent.
Now, is this Lester Dent story a previously unpublished Doc Savage story?
Sadly, no. And any leftover Doc Savage material has already been mined by Will in some of his own works. No, this is a World War I aviator story set in Europe, and don't know why it never sold, but it was one of a few that were still left that Will was looking for homes for, so this became the home. And I'm thrilled to have just anything from this man.
Now, earlier you mentioned the longevity of some of these characters that got their start in the pulps, the Shadow being one of them, Doc Savage, Conan the Barbarian, and that sort of thing. Are there characters, are there stories in this collection that could potentially lead to more stories, franchises perhaps, or are all of these one and done?
Not initially, but I do note that several of my writers created pulp characters in the mode of the Green Hornet and the Lone Ranger and the Spider and characters of that nature. And some I could easily see having continuing adventures. Either the authors will find homes for them elsewhere, or Crazy Eight will do a second anthology, or maybe something using these characters. Peter David's is called Professor Ironheart, his character. Mike Friedman's is I Am the Mask. Easily, these could have further adventures. My own story is a sword and sorcery piece from, it was a concept I had for an anthology I pitched to that I didn't make it into, but I saw the potential in exploring this realm. So here's my first story. If I get good feedback, I might go back to that world and revisit. It's entirely possible. Others, in, out, done. And, you know, it's nice to have that mix.
All right. Well, the book is called Thrilling Adventure Yarns. You can find it still on Kickstarter through February 19th. And we will, of course, put a link to the project in our show notes, as well as a link to Paul Kupperberg's blog entry over at Crazy 8 Press. Bob Greenberger, thanks very much for your time today. Good luck on the book.
Thank you, Jason. I appreciate that.